Thank you, Archbishop Vigneron, for your very kind words of introduction. We have had an opportunity over many years to work together, and I always appreciate when we have those occasions, whether it's in committee or various committees or workshops or in the conference itself. Thank you. Thank you so very much. I also want to begin by expressing my gratitude to Dr. John Cavadini, the director of the university's Institute for Church Life, and to say how much I appreciate what you do here at the university to provide opportunities for all of us, bishops and our co-workers, theologians and collaborators, to come together and spend this time together. Notre Dame provides us a great service in making all of this possible. One of the purposes of this conference is to focus on some of the intellectual, the spiritual, the pastoral resources that are to help all of us, and especially those pastors who are our collaborators in ministry, and to do this in the context of the new evangelization as we address the loss of Catholic identity, a reality that we all recognize. By way of preface, I want to turn our attention, as Archbishop Vigneron pointed out, to the 2012 Synod on the New Evangelization and its call for a reawakening of the need in the church to return to a clear and inviting proclamation of the faith. The Synod spoke of announcing the kerygma. In fact, it was Pope Benedict who was presiding over that Synod who gave the intervention, his own intervention, saying we really need to get back to the kerygma. And that formed the part of a lot of the discussion following his intervention, to do so in a way that it presents an invitation to encounter the resurrection and the person of the risen Christ. In the course of that 3-week-long synod, that 3-week-long examination of how we better offer an invitation to the faith, how do we do this? To invite people to faith in Christ. And we recognize the context, which makes this so difficult. The context is the heavily secular world. There was a continuous highlighting of that fact throughout that synod. I was prepared at the beginning to think of secularism as something that was just a first world issue. But as the synod went on, it became very clear that this is something that's being experienced throughout the world. But we were invited in that synod to take a look at how did the early church proclaim, how did the early church initiate this evangelizing that took place in a manner that brought our Christian faith to the whole world. An example of that early kerygma is St. Peter on Pentecost. The outpouring of the Spirit, we're told, prior to that outpouring, they were timid, mild. The word timid is used in Acts of the Apostles. And as soon as the Spirit was upon them, we're told, they became bold. And Peter boldly got up, and what did he announce? He announced, Christ is risen, and we have encountered him. St. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians and throughout his letters, does the same thing. The mantra, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ is with us, is this focal point of the kerygma. And it had the power to evoke allegiance. This was what made that early church so extraordinary. The proclamation, the simple proclamation, we have encountered the risen Lord. He is alive. We have met him. We have encountered him. We're here to tell you that story. It evoked from people allegiance, a spiritual adherence to the Lord Jesus. This is what inspired the first disciples, the ancient church, the witnesses, the martyrs, to live, and as we just celebrated in morning prayer today, to die for Christ. This embrace of Christ was not the acceptance of an abstraction or a moral code, but rather a living reality. As Pope Benedict XVI underlined, being Christian is not the result of an ethical choice or a lofty idea, but the encounter with an event, a person, which gives life a new horizon, a decisive direction. Too often, our Catholic faith has been perceived as an abstraction. It's an abstract moral system, primarily expressed in negatives. Before we can call people to a whole set of moral obligations and ethical standards regarding whatever the area might be, contraceptives, sterilization, sexual activity outside of marriage, the care of the poor, the immigrant, the disenfranchised, before we can call people to attention to all of those legitimate needs, we have to help people encounter and experience the embrace of Jesus himself, his love, his mercy, his way. Only then can we evoke from them a level of allegiance that would encourage them to accept our teaching and be willing to follow it, because now it has to be based on their acceptance of our word. We're the witnesses. We're the witnesses who are announcing Christ is risen. And then in the light of their acceptance of that, inviting them to embrace a whole way of life we're calling them to. What's missing today, and what the Synod on the New Evangelization highlighted, was the allegiance. There's no allegiance because there is no depth of personal conviction of encounter with the risen Lord. There's a vast wealth of knowledge about what the church says. But many times, that presentation of it is not always in a way that's favorable to us. The huge positive response to Pope Francis seems to affirm the effectiveness of preaching the loving, merciful face of God as the starting point for ongoing conversion. This desired response should follow on our own personal witness to Jesus and his way. People should be able to see in us that level of conviction that's attractive, just as it was in the early church emanating from the apostles. The apostolic exhortation Amoris Laetitia, issued on March 19, 2016 by our Holy Father Pope Francis, shows this loving openness to pastoral ministry attuned to the needs of an increasingly broken world, even if the world that is broken isn't prepared to admit its situation, it simply experiences it and isn't able well to articulate it. At the same time, the exhortation is a statement of consensus, a consensus that came out of two synods, the October 2014 and the October 2015 synods. Pope Francis approaches his teaching ministry and encourages us to do the same, first and foremost as a pastor of souls. This can be a challenge, but it can also be an incentive for all of us who seek to do the same thing. There's always the temptation simply to enunciate the doctrine, and that is important. But to enunciate the doctrine as if this were the same as engaging in pastoral ministry. And engaging in pastoral ministry, particularly with a person who is discerning how he or she can even appropriate this teaching in a way that will do what we're asked to do, live it, make it a part of our life. The pastoral ministry of accompanying the discerner benefits then from years of pastoral experience. I find with the priest in the archdiocese, when we talk about this, seasoned pastors say to me, isn't that what we do? Isn't that what we're all doing? There's a sense when you've been at ministry for a long time, there's a sense of engaging and helping someone come to discern with you where they are as you're trying to help them become more and more engaged in the mystery, and it's mystery for all of us, the mystery of Christ's way. As Pope Paul VI in Evangelii Nuntiandi said all those years ago, modern man listens more to witnesses than he does to teachers. And if he listens to teachers, it's because they're witnesses. This is not to say that we are not called to announce moral values and sexual ethics, but they cannot be the starting point or the primary concern of a church that is today struggling to help people even minimally experience the person of the risen Lord. In the most recent series of synods, one of the cardinals got up and said, much to the support of many people in the hall, he said, we keep hearing we're supposed to go out, encounter, we're supposed to engage and accompany. And he says, sometimes I feel that what we have done, and he said, now I'll just speak for myself. We go out, we engage, we encounter, and then we condemn. At least that's how we appear when we say, here are all the things you're doing wrong. It's been my great privilege since 1980 to have some working relationship with the National Catholic Bioethics Center. In all this time, I witnessed extraordinarily competent ethicist moralists work to present a moral frame of reference rooted in our Catholic faith. Yet one thing was very, very apparent in all of those yearly and now every second year workshops. There has to be some prior allegiance to the church and recognition of its value before her voice is heard and appropriated. And it's that last part that's so important. It's one thing to hear, and it's another thing to appropriate that teaching and make it your way of life. And that's what the Pope is calling us to. That's what those two synods on the family, and that was certainly what the synod on the new evangelization was all about. How do we help people appropriate something that they're having a very hard time even hearing? A moral theology with well-reasoned conclusions that rely on a robustly developed understanding of grace, virtue, and human teleology has its own inner dynamic and logic. Yet, for many, even faith-filled practicing Catholics, there's a disconnect between their reading of the gospel and Jesus' words and example and message and the checklist of moral consequences that too often is presented, not necessarily by us, but presented as the church's understanding of what it means to be a follower of Christ. Yet the very credibility of our Holy Father, so widely recognized and accepted today, is in no small part because without changing any of the teaching, he finds a way to say it so that it evokes a positive response. Not necessarily total acceptance, but the starting point is a positive response and willingness to hear the rest of it. It's precisely the credibility of Pope Francis that is lending credibility to the church's position on so many significant social, cultural, and human life issues. I got into a cab, this was a couple of months ago, in Rome, at St. Peter's, I wanted to go over to my titular church. And as I got in and told the driver where I wanted to go, he said, "Father, now only in Rome can a cab driver drive right on into the oncoming traffic and still carry on a conversation with you." And he said, "Hey, Father, have you met this Pope?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "What do you think?" And then, but that was a totally rhetorical question, because he went into saying, "You know, you can understand him when he talks. He talks a lot at that window, but you can understand what he's saying." And then, to add salt to the wound, he turned around and said, "Not like you people." Our challenge today is to invite a new generation of disciples and others who have fallen away to encounter Christ and his church as life-giving fonts of spiritual renewal, not as checklists of do's and don'ts. The Year of Mercy is the context for this invitation. And Pope Francis calls us to go out, encounter, accompany, and in so doing, draw more closely to Jesus ourselves, who is the face of God's mercy. One way of expressing the pastoral mission of the church today and our own pastoral ministry is to attend to the lived expression of mercy and love that can be found in these four principles enunciated at the time of the Synod on the New Evangelization and re-enunciated in the 2014 and 2015 Synod and made explicitly clear in Amoris Laetitia. Listening, accompanying, discerning, and evangelizing. Amoris Laetitia is itself the fruit of very intense listening on the part of Pope Francis. The two synods on family were preceded by consultation of local churches throughout the whole world on the lived experience, the lived situation of families, their challenges, and the experience of all of those in family life. The extraordinary synod of 2014 reflected on the challenges to marriage and family and thus prepared the agenda for the 2015 ordinary assembly. The second activity on which the document focuses is accompanying. The pastoral accompaniment of families by the community of the church. In many ways, this is an extension of the listening and of the synodality to which it gives rise. The journeying together of all of the members of the church implies this accompaniment, walking together at various stages wherever we find ourselves. There's no one point when the entire church is all on the same page at the same time. That may happen at the second coming, but we're not there now. And what we're engaged in and what we're invited to do is to make this journey together. It calls for a change in pastoral style and intensity. Pope Francis calls pastors to do more than teach the church's doctrine, although they clearly must do this. Pastors, he says, must take on the smell of the sheep whom they serve, so that the sheep are willing to hear their voices. Paul VI, modern man listens more to witnesses than to teachers. And if he listens to a teacher, it's because the teacher is a witness. Echoed all over again by Pope Francis, who, by the way, keeps citing and saying that Paul VI was this extraordinary influence in his own life. This requires a more careful and intense formation of all who minister to families, lay ministers, catechists, seminarians, priests, families themselves. In chapter 6, the Pope draws attention to stages of life where this pastoral accompaniment of families is particularly important. It's not just the teaching, the synod says, the synods say, and the exhortation says. It's the accompaniment as people are attempting to understand and appropriate the teaching. Annunciation of the teaching, reception of the teaching, and appropriation of the teaching are three interrelated but distinct moments in the whole process. Chapter 6 tells us these moments include preparation for marriage, the first years of marriage, during times of crisis in marriage, during marital breakdown, and when families are touched by death. The church's pastoral ministry to families is intended then to help them grow in the art of discerning, listening, appropriating, discerning. A key part of the discernment is the formation of conscience. The Holy Father insists that the church's pastors must make room for the conscience of the faithful, who very often respond as best they can to the gospel amid their limitations and are capable of carrying out their own discernment in complex situations. He reminds us we've been called to form conscience, but not to replace them. Again, part of our annunciation and invitation to encounter the risen Christ is to recognize a value as opposed to enunciating a rule. People will follow in their own lives something that they have accepted as a life-giving value much more quickly than they will appropriate something that is seen to them as an external rule. Even in the midst of their challenges and imperfections, families are called to respond to the Holy Spirit's prompting. The Holy Father goes on, admittedly, this individual process of discernment may not be easy. A person may know full well church teaching, the Pope notes, yet have great difficulty in either understanding its inherent positive value or in being able to fully embrace it right away because of the circumstances of their own lived condition. Yet the underlining moral principle, which should inform both that personal discernment and the priest's ministry, is that the person whose situation in life is objectively contrary to moral teaching can still love and grow in the faith, and he or she can still take steps in the right direction if encouraged and guided and accompanied along the way. The recognition that God's mercy and grace are open to all of us, and that the church is an essential means for that grace to reach us. So the goal is to invite, include, accompany, even as the person struggles to find out how they could possibly accept and live this. We have to remember it's the church, it's the body of Christ, that is this life-giving font. Part of our Catholic teaching, that that's where we encounter Christ in his church, and we want to invite those who are struggling to live this, to invite them to stay close to the church, stay close to that family, all of us making our own way. None of us can live up to, or claim we can live up to, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. But that's a commandment. Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus calls us to that. And all of us are saying in his church, in the body of Jesus on the face of the earth today, we're trying to do that. And we're working and walking and struggling together to do that. Amoris Laetitia is not a list of answers to each individual human issue, nor is it directed solely to the question of the reception of the Eucharist. The apostolic exhortation calls for a compassionate pastoral approach to many people, married, single, divorced, those who are struggling to face issues in life, the teaching of the church, and their own desire to reconcile all of this in some way that makes sense to them. The exhortation is a call to compassionate accompaniment in helping all to experience Christ's love and mercy. The three distinct but closely interrelated areas are the teaching of the church, revelation in matters of faith and morals. But even within the teaching of the church, we've always recognized what we used to call theological notes. Not everything has the weight of the revelation of the Trinity. But the teaching is part of what we're engaged in. But the second part is a structured appropriation and presentation of that. That's the place of law in the church. That's the place for pastoral directives and canon law, to try to provide some structure. I had the great privilege just very recently to speak to the Canon Law Society of our country on the importance of structures, but the structure does not replace the teaching. It's supposed to be an articulation of that teaching. And the third element is the personal appropriation of the teaching and the accompaniment that we owe to the person as we proclaim the teaching, point out the directives of the law, and then walk with them as they try to make this, as best they can, their own. To the extent that our ministry includes listening, accompanying, and discerning, it's also an evangelizing action. As we recall the challenge to go out, to encounter, to accompany, we also recognize that this is at the very heart of evangelization. And we need to remember ourselves in this process. We too are drawing closer to the Lord Jesus. It's not that we go out and tell people there he is. We go out, encounter, and walk with them in the hope that both of us get closer to the Lord Jesus. In approaching our task, we need, I believe, to recognize two basic realities for the evangelizing disciple today. The first is that many people simply do not know much about their Catholic faith. We've had that presentation here in subsequent workshops here at the Institute. The recognition that many, many people simply do not know very much about their faith. In talking with young adults, just about everybody under 40, although I'm finding that age is rising for me, young is getting older and older. It's not surprising to learn that most of them say that what they know about the church, their understanding of Catholic faith, is what they receive through media. What they receive through media, I don't think we should be surprised by that. And a lot of it is negative and caricature. We can perhaps best describe their faith as residual identification without personal appropriation. There's no adhesion there. The second element we have to be aware of is that active membership in the church has to be the result today of personal, intentional decision. It's no longer the result of cultural identification. Under that second heading, I think it's fair to note that in many parts of the world, from whence came our parents, grandparents, parents before them, maybe even up to a generation ago, there was a sense of permeation of the culture with Catholic faith, or at least Catholic symbols of the faith, and points of identification. That's no longer the widespread situation. That was announced over and over again in the 2012 Synod. And it certainly is not the case for people growing up in this pluralistic and heavily secular society, our country, and other parts of the world that mirror what we're facing. I base my observations again on what was said during that 2012 Synod. As I said earlier, I was prepared to think of the secularism in terms of First World. Reference was made throughout that synod to the tsunami of secularism, and every single representative of the continents that was asked to speak, reflecting the church in their part of the world, spoke about the inroads of secularism, the power of secularism, the overriding dominance of secularism. Here we're talking about not the separation of church and state, church and secular. We're talking about an ideology that says the secular, that is, the non-transcendent point of reference in life, is the only valid norm for discerning the values and enunciating the values of culture and society. It's against this background, a diminished appreciation of the faith, that the Pope calls us in this year to the year of mercy and to a continuing new evangelization. The starting point is our recognition that we do have something unique. We have something unique to bring to the world that no one else can. And that should encourage us to have the confidence to say what we believe. We have a specific message, even in the context of a pluralistic culture, and as we sometimes see, an increasingly hostile secular culture. A number of years ago, I was invited to speak at the Catholic Center at Harvard. And the talk was the role of faith in a pluralistic society. At the conclusion of my presentation, a man who self-identified as an atheist and the moderator said to me, he teaches in the law school. I said, well, it doesn't matter, he has his hand up. And he said, what do you people think you bring to our society? The you people wasn't just directed to me. The front row was, this was an interfaith gathering, so everybody that was there, and we were all dressed in our identifying raiment. And so the you people was all these faith traditions. What do you think you people bring? Since he was a lawyer, and I had always been told that a lawyer never asks a question the answer to which he doesn't already know, I said to him, do you mind if I ask you a question before I try to answer yours? And he said, no, go right ahead. And I asked him, what do you think the world would be like if it weren't for the voices of all those people? What do you think the world would be like if it weren't for all of those religious traditions? What would it be like? What would our culture be like if we hadn't heard growing up, you shall not kill, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness? What would our culture be like if we had not heard religious imperatives such as love your neighbor as yourself, do unto others as you would have them do to you, the golden rule that our Holy Father enunciated when speaking to Congress, knowing that it would have been accepted by everybody in that hall? And an interesting thing, in speaking to the joint session of Congress, as the Holy Father began the golden rule, most of them completed it standing and applauding. How much more harsh would our land be, I said, if we did not grow up hearing, blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, blessed are the merciful, blessed are the peacemakers. What would our world be like if we had never been reminded that someday we're going to be asked to give an accounting of our actions? And to his credit, he said, it would be a mess. It would be a mess. The church brings what it has always brought. We bring an invitation to faith. We can't impose that faith, but we bring an invitation to faith. We bring an invitation to an encounter with the Lord Jesus, and we bring an invitation to walk in the way of the Lord. And the new evangelization is the term that has become the way of saying that for our age. St. John Paul II began more than three decades ago to use that term. And he described it as the announcement of the good news about Jesus that is new in ardor, method, and expression. The message isn't new. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ is with us. We're anointed in the Holy Spirit. But what is new is the ardor, the method, and the expression. Ardor refers to the energy level, the desire and the commitment. We must not only know what the church proclaims, we have to be able to share it with a certain level of enthusiasm. Method speaks to utilizing the best that is available technologically, culturally. This is an area where the church has such a long, long way to go. Talking to most of the young people that I get to meet with on our university campuses, the communications, it's all taking place in the palm of their hand. They're not buying our newspapers. They're not going to our websites. They're not listening to talks and sermons and homilies and church bulletins. So much is what is being communicated electronically, immediately, and in a language that they can, they think, absorb in less than 15 seconds or 140 characters. We have a long, long way to go. Expression. Expression turns our attention to what St. John the 23rd said, and he's quoted by St. John Paul II in the announcement of the call for the council. The council, quote, was not first of all to condemn the errors of the time, but above all to strive calmly to show the strength and the beauty of the doctrine of the faith. Pope Benedict affirmed that the discernment of the new demands of evangelization is, as he put it, the prophetic task of the Supreme Pontiff. Likewise, in continuity with his predecessors, Pope Francis calls us to the work of the new evangelization, and the hallmark of this papacy is the emphasis that the church go out into the world, to not stay wrapped up in herself, but to go out and to give to people the beauty of the gospel, the amazement of the encounter with Christ. If we're going to have, as we move forward, a time of blessing, and I believe we will, a time of renewal, and I believe we will have that, then it will require a renewed commitment to that pastoral outreach so evident in the ministry of Pope Francis. We're historically in a new and very engaging moment. Immediately following the council, the Second Vatican Council in the late 60s, I've taken now to adding that definition. I don't say council any longer because too many times at the university, when talking to university students, they say, "What council?" And I realize how long ago for them that is. Two summers ago, as I was interviewing the students coming into our college level seminary, an 18-year-old coming into the freshman class said to me, trying to be as nice as possible, "Is it true that you were alive at the time of the Second Vatican Council?" And he realized how odd that sounded. And he said, "What I meant to say was," I said, "No, I know what you're saying." The Second Vatican Council. Following the council, there was a period of renewal and development totally consistent with the direction of the council, and on the other hand, ways that diverged dramatically from what the council said and the received tradition of the church. This was particularly evident in areas of liturgy and catechesis, where the so-called spirit of the council was invoked to override the actual words of the council. The tradition of the church and anything else that was all a part of what the council had sought to pass on in more intelligible terms. What emerged was a new hermeneutic, often invoked to support liturgical aberration and catechetical misrepresentation, the hermeneutic of discontinuity, and it was rampant in the 70s and 80s and well into the 90s. It was one of the reasons why, together with a number of other people, including a very, very dear friend and highly learned priest, Father Ronald Lawler, we began all the way back in the 70s a catechism, the teaching of Christ for adults, because the discontinuity was reigning in many, many, many of our institutions of higher learning. It was Pope Benedict XVI who sought explicitly to point out the failings and the unacceptability of the hermeneutic of discontinuity, which he contrasted with what he baptized as the true hermeneutic of renewal and reform, where we have to be today, where the synods, recent synods, have been calling us. Unfortunately, a side effect of the hermeneutic of discontinuity was a hermeneutic of suspicion. And so often today, when we're dealing with the hermeneutic of renewal and reform, there's also a counter hermeneutic of suspicion. From the days of the Council until today, the Church has been greatly blessed, however, with touchstones, a series of pontiffs, successors to Peter, who have so well served the Church. In March of 2013, guided by the Holy Spirit, the Cardinals of the Church chose Jorge Mario Bergoglio to fill the chair of Peter. He took the name Francis, but his ministry follows on the stability reestablished by Pope John Paul II, now saint, and the theological depth of Pope Benedict XVI. What he does is, standing on that stability and that reconnectedness to the authentic interpretation of the Council, he calls us now to do what we proclaim, to do what the Council says, to do what that whole vast array of apostolic exhortations and encyclicals that is the corpus of St. John Paul II. When you go back and you look at what he wrote, there is a reflection on every aspect of the Second Vatican Council. Before the conclave was dissolved that elected him, John Paul II said to the cardinals who elected him, "My task, this pontificate, will be devoted to the implementation of the Council." Look at the exhortations and the encyclicals, and you see an effort made to do precisely that. And an instrument that all four used, Paul VI, John Paul II, Benedict XVI, and now Francis, an instrument they used to refocus the direction of the Church and its emphasis on correct governance, structure, and leadership, was and remains the Synod of Bishops. Here we see an effort to engage the bishops with Peter in the overall care of the whole Church. In September of 1965, it was Paul VI who said, "If we're going to continue this dynamic of the Council, if we're going to continue this forward-moving guidance of the Holy Spirit, of the bishops with Peter, never without, moving the Church forward, we have to find a structure." And he announced the Synod of Bishops. In Apostolica Sollicitudo, he established what now you and I are familiar with, but then it was a brand new structure, and it had these purposes. It was to provide valued assistance in the work of the sovereign pontiff and the bishops around the world. Second, to ensure and direct that real information is made available to both. And thirdly, to facilitate agreement on essential points of doctrine and on methods of procedure in the life of the Church. Ecclesiologically, what Pope Francis has done is to refocus once again on the ministry of the College of Bishops, as was the case of the Second Vatican Council, Lumen Gentium. It's precisely here that we find the Church called. Peter and the bishops. The bishops and Peter, always with and never without, to take the responsibility for the overall guidance and direction of the Church. Admittedly, this movement today of individual discernment is a challenging one. It's not easy. But in none of the synodal documents does it say this will be an easy thing. But it calls us, especially the last two synods, Animoris Laetitia, to once again re-engage in the work, the bishops with Peter and never without, of presenting in a beautiful, engaging way that people can actually recognize the truth of the message, Jesus risen, and a way of life that would follow on adherence to him. A person may know full well the teaching of the church. Pope Francis notes, yet that same person might have great difficulty in either understanding the inherent positive value or in being able to fully embrace it right at this moment because of all the circumstances in that person's life. Yet the underlying moral principle, which should inform both that personal discernment and the priest's ministry, is that a person whose situation in life is objectively contrary to moral teaching can still love and grow in faith. He or she can still take steps in the right direction and benefit from God's mercy and grace in receiving the assistance, the ministerial pastoral assistance of the church. And that's where we all come in. Bishops, priests, lay leaders, parish ministers, ensuring that people know they're welcome, even if none of us can say, I have it all together, thank God. But they're welcome in the process of trying to draw closer, in the action of going out, encountering, sharing, and accompanying. We also recognize that in the journey, we ourselves are drawing closer to the Lord. One reason I believe so many priests have greeted this apostolic exhortation with joy and a certain sense of satisfaction is that we're grateful. We're grateful for a guidance that says, this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to do this, walk with our people, even though none of us can claim to already be there. Walk with our people, and at no point do we want to start excluding. As we get closer now to the amount of time we have for the rest of this presentation, I want to just touch on what I would call some theological foundational blocks that you and I have to be aware of and work with. It's one thing to go and encounter people, but in the encounter, you have to bring something. You have to bring something in the process of trying to invite them to walk with us in the church. And I find this is probably the most challenging part of it. Walk with us in the church. Isn't that what distinguishes us from all the other Christian communities? For us, the church is essential to the act of salvation. We believe in the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and we profess our faith in the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. Why? Because the church is the presence of Christ in the world. I wish at times we had the same enthusiasm for explaining that as we run into with so many others. I got on to a plane not all that long ago. And if any of you have ever flown in an Embraer, you know that you really become friendly with the person next to you. And so as I went to take my seat, the aisle seat, the woman at the window seat said to me, have you been born again? I said, excuse me? And she said, have you been born again? I thought this would have given it away, but I said, yes. And she said, when? And I said, when I was baptized. Oh, she said, you're Catholic. Yes. And she said, you Catholics are big into this church thing, aren't you? Can you tell me a little bit about it? And I said, yes, if you let me sit down. And then I said to her, in one of your bags, one of which is under my seat, in one of your bags, do you have a New Testament? And she said, no. But I have cards with quotes on them from the New Testament. I said, the one I want, I don't think you have. Do you have the one that says, you're Peter and on this rock I will build my church? No, I don't have that one. I said, well, it's very important for an understanding of why we're so big into church. And she said, tell me about it. I thought, thought, you asked for it. And on the rest of the flight, we talked about things that we normally just take for granted, that the church is something more than just the coming together of like-minded Christians, that the sacraments do something to you that changes you, that Peter is head of this church on earth and the focal point of our unity as body. Anyway, we had a nice conversation, but when we landed and taxied up to the gate, the man across the aisle turned and said, "Hey, Father, I could hear that conversation." Well, I thought everybody in the plane probably could. And he said, "I'm Catholic. I didn't know any of that." The idea of church, the foundation blocks that we need if we're going to successfully have something to bring to the conversation when we do go out and engage and encounter. The first of these four blocks I would call the anthropological foundation block. Our starting point is human beings, made male and female, by their nature social beings, are created in the image and likeness of God, a triune God who is love and truth, and we're made to live in relationship and community. That's the starting point for the anthropological foundation block. The new evangelization has to point out that the dignity of the human person, whose inherent nature is not to exist in solitude, as merely individuals closed in on themselves, but in solidarity with each other. In short, we ask for an authentic humanism. The fact that each person is created in the image and likeness of God forms the basis for declaring, for example, the universality of human rights, the harmony that should exist among people. We have to speak with conviction to a doubting civil world about the truth and integrity of realities such as marriage, family, a natural moral order, and objective right and wrong. The challenge is to find the language in which to say that, to engage in a conversation. The second foundation block is Christological. Who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? Every disciple answers back as Peter did, "You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God." And on that profession came the response, "Yes, and you're Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." And that brings us to the third of these foundational blocks, the ecclesiological. You're Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. The new evangelization must always clearly explain the necessity of the church for salvation. Our salvation is intimately related to our participation in the great sacrament that is the church. And the fourth of those foundational blocks is what I would call the soteriological foundation. That's the simple recognition that there is a kingdom of God coming to be. It's already started here and now, but it will only reach its fulfillment in eternity. And that there is an eternity. And that there's a passageway into that eternity that we call death, and after death, the judgment. In concluding these reflections, I want to just touch on what I would call the qualities of this new evangelizer, the quality of the person who is going to be the voice of a church reaching out to bring people to the risen Lord. There are probably a whole list of them that you could come up with. I'm just going to touch on four. The evangelizing disciple has to have these qualities. One, a boldness or a courage. The boldness or courage that comes from recognizing we do stand in the truth. We've received the outpouring of the Holy Spirit just as those apostles did. Every one of us has been baptized in the Holy Spirit. We have to not only know what it is the creed says, That's why Benedict asked for a year of faith. But we have to have the confidence that it's true, and therefore the boldness to say it. The second is our connectedness to the church. There's no way in which any one of us can claim to have an intuitive understanding of what the truth of the church and the faith and the revelation really is. We only receive it in and through the church and in communion with the bishops gathered with and never without Peter. The connectedness to the church. The third is a sense of urgency. The evangelizing disciple today has to have a sense of urgency. It's our turn. It's our turn. This faith has been passed down generation after generation for 2,000 years. But it only happens because in every generation there are those who accept, it's my turn now to do that. And finally, there should be a sense of joy. A sense of joy. We have the greatest message of all. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and we live in his new life. There is no better, more joyful, more life-giving message. And yet sometimes what comes across is not always the most joyful annunciation of it. My brothers and sisters, this is a new moment in the life of the church. I think we can all recognize a sense of new Pentecost. I think we just have to be open to the gift of the Spirit. It's the movement of the Spirit that has led us along this path. It's the nudging of the Spirit that brings us to this moment. And it's the outpouring of the Spirit that we have to find in that outpouring our source of energy and our source of delight in being united with Christ at the service of his bride. Thank you.